which we extract gallium citrate and label every day with different pharmaceuticals. I will come about discuss about gallium citrate based tracers in the end of the presentation. What is the advantage of PET and CT and why PET and CT are needed? See, as you know, the difference between nuclear medicine and conventional radiology is that nuclear medicine or PET gives a lot of functional information, whereas CT gives structural information. But because reading the PET images is difficult, nowadays with the advances in the computer science, positron images are fused with CT images and we get together the information what is obtained from the PET, that is functional or metabolic information. And these information is based on physiology and biochemistry or receptor expression or antigen expression. Unlike CT, where the what we get is information only about the structure of organs, and the contrast what we use gives only delineation of blood vessels, but does not give the metabolic or functional information of different structures. So when we fuse both the images, you get an image which gives both structure and function, and the contrast from the PET image is superior to contrast from a CT image. See here, you can see in a CT image there is something here. We think it might be related to stomach only, but on a PET CT image you can see this is very, very metabolically active. It is brighter than rest of the structure. So basically it was a pathological lymph node. So, and how does a PET CT scanner look like? It is a bigger CT scan, almost looks like an MRI. And here you can see, it is not a very big, it does not cause any claustrophobia, does not produce any sound like MRI, but it is a very, very, big equipment, but just looks like a CT scan, does not make any noise. In the scanner, in the front portion, we have a CT scan, and in the back side, we have a PET scanner. They are put together in tandem, and when the patient scan is done, initially his CT scan will be done, a whole body CT scan will be done from head to toe, and then he will be shifted to a PET gantry. And in the PET gantry, these images are acquired from caudal to cranial direction, because urinary bladder fills up in the end of the study, so we want to avoid any interference from the excreted activity in the urinary bladder. And within a short time, nowadays we have got very high-end computers which produce both the CT images, which do all the reconstruction and produce fused images within no time. You can imagine, just 15-20 years back, a CT scan of only head or abdomen used to take almost 1 to 1.5 hours. Nowadays, whole body CT as well as PET images with the reconstructed images are obtained in 5 to 10 minutes. So that is the beauty of the technology. So what are the characteristics of PET CT scanners? Nowadays, all the CT scanners in the PET CT machine are multi-slice CT only. Like it can be 16 slice, 64, 128, or even 256 slice CT scanner. But for oncological imaging and most of the routine imaging, 16 slice scanners are sufficient. More than 16, like 64, 128 or 256 slice CT scanners are more useful in cardiac imaging. Whereas for all other organ imaging, 16 slice is very good, and you can get multiplanar reconstructions, volume rendering, submillimeter sections. Even with our CT scanner, we can get 0.3 to 5 millimeter cuts. So there is no need to get a diagnostic separate diagnostic CT scan. And this is a misunderstanding which is even today prevailing in many referring physicians. They think PET CT is different from a CT. So you can see here, we can get axial cuts, coronal cuts, axial and fused images, sagittal cuts, and we can also get multi maximum intensity profile images, both of the CT and PET CT fused images. So this is beautifully, you can get the structural and functional information which will help in planning a surgery or radiotherapy or like that. So the most commonly used PET CT is F18 fluorodeoxyglucose PET CT. So this is the normal cellular glucose metabolism. A small recap, see what in a normal individual, what happens is whenever we take glucose, it initially enters into glycolytic pathway where it is acted upon by a glucose 6-phosphatase enzyme to get glucose 6 hexokinase enzyme to become glucose 6 phosphate. Then it is acted upon by glucose 6 phosphatase enzyme, and subsequently it enters into glycolytic pathway, and then TCA cycle and energy is derived. Now, fluorodeoxyglucose is nothing but glucose, but in the second position, the oxygen is removed. That is why it is called as deoxyglucose, and it is substituted by fluorinating. That is why it is called as fluorodeoxyglucose. Now, fluorodeoxyglucose is also taken up by all the cells, just like a glucose, and it is acted upon by hexokinase to become FDG6-phosphate. But FDG6-phosphate is not a substrate for subsequent enzymatic reaction. So it gets trapped. So it does not enter into glycolytic pathway. So it gets trapped. And in a neoplastic cell, there is increased expression of glucose transporter proteins. Here you can see there is increased, all these structures are nothing but glucose transporter proteins. And also there is increased expression of hexokinase enzymes, because of which there is increased trapping of glucose. And another important feature of neoplastic cells is they get their energy mainly by glycolysis but not by TCA cycle. So this is called as aerobic glycolysis and Warburg effect. Even in the presence of oxygen, the neoplastic cells derive their energy by glycolysis. So, since they express more of glucose transporter proteins and more of hexokinase enzyme, there is progressive accumulation of FDG6-phosphate in the cells. It cannot come out of the cell also, or very little of it comes out. So, this is called as metabolic trapping. Now, this intensity of FDG uptake can be semi-quantitatively assessed by something called as standardized uptake value. So, you would have seen in many of the reports, any tumor tissue is there which shows increased metabolic activity with a maximum SUV value of XYZ. But we have to bear in mind that it is a marker of de-differentiation and aggressiveness, but it cannot differentiate a benign tumor from a malignant tumor. And also tumor heterogeneity is another important thing. Within a body, the primary site as well as metastatic sites have different metabolic activity. So, we don't rely on SUV value per se for differentiating between a benign and malignant condition. We also have to carefully see the images, and primarily we have to see the aggressive extent of involvement, any infiltration of adjacent structures and other such things to call it as malignant. But SUV value is very important in follow-up and treatment response assessment, which we'll come to know in the latter slides. And preparation for FDG PET-CT. Because it is a fluorodeoxyglucose is an analog of glucose, overnight fasting is needed, and fasting blood sugar preferably should be less than 150 milligrams per deciliter, because more normal glucose will interfere with the FDG uptake by the tumor cells, and there will be a lot of background activity, and false negative results can come, or false reduced uptake can come. And the dose of FDG administered is around 6 to 10 millicuries. Nowadays, we have very advanced detectors in PET scanners which have very high sensitivity. We can do images, we can get very good images even with 3 to 5 millicuries. Thereby, since most of the malignant cancer patients will get repeated scans, we try to reduce the radiation burden as much as possible. So, we are tending towards usage of reduced FDG activity. Adequate hydration is important, but we should not administer DNS. This is very important. Patients are not allowed to take fruit juice, tea, coffee or milk. Only plain water is allowed. And after injection, there is a waiting period of around 45 to 60 minutes. And whole body scans again mean head to mid thigh in most of the patients. So this again, you have to bear in mind, because sometimes we get queries from patients that below knee, ankle and all are not covered. In most of the malignancies, below knee images are not required, except in few scenarios like melanomas or primary malignant lymph nodes in the lower limbs or sarcomas or having sarcomas like such diseases. So this is how a normal FDG distribution looks like in the body. This is normal physiological uptake in the brain. Some variable uptake will be in the heart, a very low uptake in the liver, spleen, kidneys, and excreted activity in urinary tract, urinary bladder. Whenever patients have a lot of, if they have done some muscular exercise and all, they can get some muscular uptake also. In young patients, we get brown fat FDG uptake. So this is called as a MIP image, maximum intensity profile image. So where you can get a bird's eye view of overall distribution in the body. And by seeing many normal images, you can make out, okay, all these bright images. In the beauty of nuclear medicine images are we can get in different color scales. Unlike CT where it is only black and white, in nuclear medicine, you can get all types of color images, which enhances, which will bring down some monotony, but also improves in detecting pathological uptake. So now coming to FDG PET CT in head and neck malignancies. So in head and neck malignancies, FDG PET CT is used in diagnosis, staging or restaging, both for lymph nodal status and distant metastasis, and treatment planning or radiotherapy planning, monitoring response to treatment, and in follow-up surveillance. So under these categories, PET CTs are used, and I will also discuss under each category. So coming to diagnosis, in malignancy of unknown origin, when a patient with cervical lymphadenopathy where biopsy has already been done and or FNAC has been done, which shows metastatic tumors, the nowadays PET CT has become the investigation of choice. It has virtually replaced pan endoscopy or CT or MRI, because we have a lot of literature support to say that PET CT is most sensitive in such cases, and it is preferably done before biopsy. You can do an FNAC, but it is preferably done before biopsy to avoid false positive imaging. And the yield is seen in almost 50 to 70% of patients, but still 25 to 30% of patients remain malignancy of unknown origin. Means we will not be able to pick up the primary uptake. So it is very important for treatment planning, because you can plan a targeted site. You can target a site for biopsy or surgical excision, which will go unnoticed even with a detailed clinical examination or video endoscopy examination. Whereas with the PET CT, increased metabolic activity, you can concentrate on that particular site for any morphological changes visually and do a guided biopsy. And also it reduces radiotherapy target volume. In head and neck area, it is a very narrow area with lot of important structures. So planning a radiotherapy field and to reduce bystander effect or reduce radiation to normal structures is very important. And also in 5 to 15% of patients, we have distant metastasis, which will change the radical treatment planning to palliative treatment. But there are some limitations. Superficial lesions are often missed, whether it is in tongue or buccal mucosa or lips or floor of mouth. Superficial lesions are often missed. We have, because physiological uptake in excreted salivary activity or Waldeyer's ring or tonsils or even the muscle, because of torticollis or positional irregularity, the normal physiological uptake in these structures will interfere with the pathological uptake. But even then, in malignancy of unknown origin, PET CT plays a very important role. Here you can see this patient had presented with left upper cervical lymphadenopathy, and on a PET CT, on a CT hardly there will be any structural change. But on a PET CT, you can make out there is a focus of intense uptake at the base of tongue at the involving median glossoepiglottic fold, and on further guided biopsy, you can see you can confirm this as the primary site. If this is another patient with bilateral cervical lymphadenopathy, you can make out there is a bulky nasopharynx and with intense metabolic activity. See, now because of in all these cases, we do thin narrow recon acquisition as well as post acquisition reconstructions, and we can comment about erosion of skull base or vertebral bodies or pterygoid process and extension. So whatever information you can get out of a normal CT scan, we can comment about those information, the carotid encasement, IJV thrombosis, everything in a CT you can comment about. But you have to bear in mind, for T staging, always MRI has some advantage over CT. This is another patient who had right lower cervical lymphadenopathy, and many a times we have seen with the patient presents with the cervical lymphadenopathy, but the lesion would be sitting somewhere else. Say, for example, in this patient, he had a lesion in right lung upper lobe with mediastinal nodes and also a metastatic subcutaneous deposit in right lower chest wall. So here you can see this is a BIP image. All these dark spots are abnormal sites. So you have to evaluate these regions very carefully by triangulating the images. Here you can see by looking at this MIP image only, we can get a fair idea. Oh, okay, this patient has a lesion in right upper chest, so that should be the primary lesion. And we can, over a period of time, our confidence level has significantly increased because we get biopsy feedback from the clinicians. So we can confidently say this patient is a primary in the lung. And within a single image, you have also found a metastatic deposit in right lower chest wall. We can also pick up bone lesions or any other visceral lesions. However, as I said, in some cases, even with bilateral cervical lymphadenopathy, here you can make out, say, the primary lesion is not seen. So even though this MIP images shows some uptake in the upper part of the face, later it was found to be a physiological uptake in the floor of the mouth in the digastric muscles. So this patient remained a malignancy upon non-origin even after PET CT. So now, staging. Once a diagnosis is made, next we have to do the staging. So in a known head and neck malignancies like buccal mucosa or floor of mouth or tonsils or any other known head and neck malignancies, there is no clear recommendation for in clinical T1 or T2. And it is not recommended in clinical N0 setting also. In all these cases, MRI is better. However, clinical T3 or T4 disease, there is a change in radiotherapy planning after PET CT in almost 20% of patients, because especially we will pick up nodal fields. We have to bear in mind that in CT and MRI, nodal metastasis is based on size criteria. Like in head and neck, more than 1 centimeter, in JD region, it is more than 1.5 centimeter, rest of the neck is more than 1 centimeter nodes, we call it could be metastatic. Whereas in a PET CT, it is based on metabolic criteria and tumor burden in the node. And most of the cases, even less than 5 millimeter node, if it is having a metastatic deposit, we can pick up on a PET CT. So we don't rely on size criteria, but it is mainly on PET criteria. That is why for nodal staging, PET CT is more sensitive and more specific than MRI or CT. MRI may be sensitive, but it is not very specific. PET CT has more specificity than MRI. But no imaging is 100% sensitive or specific for nodes because histopathology is the gold standard. And in 7 to 25% of the patients with advanced head and neck cancer can have distant metastasis, and therefore it alters management from radical surgery to palliative intent. So for example, this is a patient with floor of mouth, base of tongue lesion, which is locally advanced. You expect a node on the ipsilateral side, but here you can make out this patient, apart from having right level 2 node, also had left level 2 and left level 5 node. On a CT, this was a very small node, less than 5 millimeter, but because of PET, we could pick up this node. Sometimes we pick up even superior mediastinal or suprasternal notch nodes on a PET CT because of metabolic sensitivity. In some head and neck cancers, there are synchronous second primary malignancies. For example, this patient who had a left upper cervical lymphadenopathy and the primary lesion was not picked up, there was a faint focal uptake at the base of the tongue, but this turned out to be negative, and but he had a very big lesion in chest. But immunohistochemistry in this patient revealed them to be of different origin. Like this was metastatic squamous cell carcinoma, this was an adenocarcinoma. So often head and neck cancers can have dual malignancies. We know aerodigestive tract, we can have synchronous second primary malignancies. And coming to a metastatic staging, again, 15% of head and neck cancers have distant metastasis and they usually carry a bad prognosis. Again, in such cases, PET CT is the investigation of choice. So clinically advanced stages and high clinical suspicion, and also before doing any radical surgeries like commando operation or salvage radical surgeries, it is always good to rule out any distant metastasis, because all the radical surgeries carry high risk of morbidity and also financial burden to the patient. Nowadays, we see many upper class patients who are ready to spend any amount of money for a thinking that it is curable, but they will be having some distant metastasis. So nowadays, we always get, before planning any radical surgeries, a PET CT is done to rule out any distant metastasis. And even NCCN guidelines recommend consideration of FDG PET CT in assessment of initial treatment strategy in locally advanced clinically stage 3 or stage 4 oral cavity, pharynx and larynx cancers, nasopharyngeal cancer, or any other head and neck cancer of unknown primary, and even mucosal melanomas. So yes, sometimes other advantage of PET CT is, many times nowadays we are seeing marrow metastasis. There is no much structural changes on CT, but because of as you know, most of the tumors initially they get deposited in the bone marrow and then they start osteoclastic or osteoblastic reaction, which is picked up by a CT scan or MRI scan. But on a PET CT scan, we are seeing bone marrow metastasis in head and neck malignancies or even prostate cancers, which is considered to show only osteoblastic metastasis. But with the development of PET CT, we are seeing lot of marrow metastasis, which are picked up before any structural changes happen on CT or MRI. Again, in radiotherapy planning, there is a significant difference between GTV CT versus GTV PET. And because of smaller GTV on a PET, but GTV for the primary tumor, but GTV of lymph nodes are larger on a PT, on a PET CT, overall survival and disease-free survival on a GTV PET is better than based on only CT or MRI. So it improves in dosimetry and bystander effect, post-radiotherapy, stenosis of aerodigestive tract, or post-radiotherapy rigidity or any other side effects. So locally advanced head and neck cancers, FDG PET CT modifies treatment concept and improves target definition in most of the patients. And there are multiple publications. So therefore, nowadays in majority of head and neck malignancies before radiotherapy planning, PET CT is being used very frequently. But locally advanced head and neck cancer, for bone marrow infiltration, like in head mandibular infiltration or perineural extension, MRI has got slight advantage over PET CT. Again, in post-treatment evaluation, PET CT plays very important role in selecting appropriate patients for salvage therapy for after chemoradiotherapy. And it has also got very high negative predictive value. And the recommendations are that you have to do a PET CT after 8 to 12 weeks of completion of treatment. But if there is any doubts clinically of suspecting recurrence or residual disease, you can do earlier. Otherwise, it is better to wait for at least as long as possible after radiotherapy, because post-radiation changes will interfere with interpretation. We have got something called as Hopkins criteria for evaluation of FDG PET CT. Like if the uptake at primary site and nodes is less than IJV, we call it as complete metabolic response. If it is uptake is slightly higher than IJV but less than liver, it is again likely metabolic complete response. Diffuse uptake more than IJV or liver uptake is again likely post radiation inflammation. But focal uptake greater than liver is of concern for residual tumor, and in these patients, more aggressive clinical examination and biopsy is recommended. and focal intense uptake at the primary or distant site or any new sites are suggestive of residual tumor. And this is a landmark study which was published in 2 years back in NEJM. It's called PET-NEXT studies. So here the purpose of this study was locally advanced neck malignancy of oropharynx or hypopharynx or larynx or occult head and neck cancer tumors after chemoradiotherapy who are otherwise fit for neck dissection, whether to do neck dissection or not, because neck dissection carries its own morbidity and injury to other organs. So in such cases, so whether to do neck dissection or if PET CT is negative, can we follow them conservatively was the purpose of this study. So they had randomized the patients in 1:1 ratio for planned neck dissection before or after chemoradiotherapy, or chemoradiotherapy followed by PET CT 10 to 12 weeks post treatment, and neck dissection only if PET CT showed incomplete or equivocal response of nodal disease, and they followed up for almost 3 years. And they found out that hazard ratio for overall survival was almost equal in both the groups, suggestive of non-inferiority. And they concluded that PET CT guided active surveillance versus neck dissection in these patients results in considerable fewer neck dissections, lesser complications. Therefore, it is routinely recommended, and even NCCN recommends the same thing. Like if the diagnosis is confirmed or progression, you do neck dissection. If no lymph node or lymph node less than 1 centimeter with no FDG uptake, you do follow up, close follow up or observation. If the node is less than 1 centimeter but FDG positive, do biopsy or consider ultrasound guided FNAC. Or if the patient is apprehensive, you can consider neck dissection. Lymph node more than 1 centimeter, but again PET CT negative, FDG uptake is not there. Again, this you have to do a more aggressive investigation or surgery based on clinical hunch or patient request. If the lymph node is more than 1 centimeter, or if it is FDG positive, neck dissection is recommended. A close follow up with CT and MRI. Again, if you do only CT or MRI, the recommendation is to consider FDG PET CT if equivocal findings are there on CT and MRI. Therefore, PET CT has now virtually replaced CT and PET in all these patients post chemoradiotherapy response assessment. Again, in long term surveillance, most of the PET CT head and neck malignancies can develop distant metastasis at a rate of almost 15%. And it is maximum in initial 1 to 2 years. And many of them can also have second malignancies. And many studies have shown that overall 18% develop second malignancies, and almost 15 to 20% patients develop distant metastasis, which is maximum in 1 to 2 years. The advantage of PET CT is it has got a very high negative predictive value. And if a single or if two PET CTs at an interval of 6 months are consecutively negative, then they have very high disease-free survival rate. And some people say it can also eliminate a routine post-treatment imaging if there is no clinical suspicion of tumor recurrence. And now coming to other malignancies, salivary gland malignancies, again, in not useful in primary, very early stages to differentiate between benign versus malignant tumors. We can have benign conditions like Watkins tumor or even pleomorphic adenoma, which is otherwise benign, can have variable or very high FDG uptake. So we don't use it for differentiation of benign versus malignant salivary gland tumor. But in advanced, locally advanced stages, the same principle as applicable to other head and neck squamous cell carcinomas applies to salivary gland malignancy. Another important thing is salivary gland malignancies, many of them are very aggressive, can have distant metastasis. Therefore, in locally advanced stages, it is always good to do a PET CT before planning any radical procedure. In thyroid cancer, we had discussed last time only, it is not routinely indicated in primary diagnosis. But it is indicated in follow-up where thyroglobulin is elevated, but iodine scan is negative. And in up, but another important thing is in many of the otherwise other malignancy, other solid organ malignancies, we find FDG with nodules in the thyroid. For example, a breast cancer or lymphoma or any head and neck cancer or any other GI malignancies, many of them we have FDG with nodules in the thyroid. Almost up to 30% of cases in some series have been shown to have FDG with nodules in thyroid. But all do they need an aggressive addresser? The recommendation is no. If the patient can survive the initial malignancy, like a patient can have locally advanced breast cancer and she undergoes all the chemo radiotherapy, surgery, everything, and she is disease free for almost 3 to 6 months, then you can address a thyroid cancer, thyroid nodule. Otherwise, if it's a metastatic breast cancer, metastatic lung cancer, incidentally detected FDG with nodule in the thyroid, nothing needs to be done, because thyroid cancer, even if it is malignant, malignant behaves much less aggressively compared to other malignancies. But FDG is not a perfect cancer imaging agent, because it reflects only glucose metabolism. And as I said, it because of nutritional status, there is normal uptake in many other structures, and there can be some pathologies other than cancer. Like for example, in India, tuberculosis is a great masquerading agent. So many a times we cannot differentiate a tubercular lymph node versus malignant lymph node, and many of the patients can have coexistent tuberculosis. In all these cases, aggressive biopsy or FNAC is definitely needed. And in some cancers, there is no uptake. So in all such cases, we have other tracers, which we call non-FDG PET-CT. And the most important one such tracer is gallium-68-DOTANOG. Gallium-68-DOTANOG is nothing but octreotide. Earlier, you would have heard about octreotide, which is a somatostatin receptor analog, and which is used in neuroendocrine tumors, medullary CA thyroid, or any other tumors of neuroendocrine origin. So in head and neck tumors, especially, it is very useful in head and neck paragangliomas. So most of the glomus tumor or paragangliomas are very FDG avid. Here you can see this patient had bilateral neck tumors, and biopsy is often risky because of high vascularity in such patients. If there is a clinical suspicion, or if CT or MRI are equivocal in all such cases, you can do a gallium-68-DOTANOG scan, which has replaced earlier days we used to hear about indium-111 octreotide or MIBG scan. But gallium-68-DOTANOG scan has virtually replaced all those radio tracers. Here you can see this patient had right bilateral paragangliomas and also had multiple liver metastases, which were not MIBG avid. So nowadays we use gallium-68-DOTANOG for diagnosis as well as treatment of metastatic neuroendocrine tumors. Another important tumor is even medullary carcinoma thyroid. Medullary carcinoma thyroid are variably FDG avid and variably DOTANOG avid also, depending on degree of differentiation. All the neuroendocrine tumors, they can, depending on differentiation, if they are very well differentiated, they are DOTANOG avid. That means they express somatostatin receptor with very high affinity for somatostatin receptor analog. But as the tumors de-differentiate or become more aggressive, then DOTANOG uptake reduces, but FDG uptake increases. But in medullary CA thyroid, most of the studies say DOTANOG and PET-CT, FDG PET-CT have a complementary role to play in diagnosis of metastatic sites, especially after initial curative surgery and radiotherapy. So here is an example who had, after initial radiotherapy, rising calcitonin levels. Many a times only on CT or MRI to differentiate between post-treatment changes versus pathological residual disease becomes difficult. In such cases, PET-CT is very important in differentiating post treatment fibrosis versus residual disease. Here you can see all these dark spots. He had a residual tissue in the neck as well as some superior mediastinal lymph nodes. So once you diagnose any metastasis, so most of the neuroendocrine tumors, there is no very good chemotherapy or targeted biological therapy available. So in such patients, we have something, some more thing to offer, that is nuclear medicine tracers, which are labeled with high energy emitting tracers. Like as in the previous presentation, I had told lutetium-177 or iodine-131, which emit higher energy beta rays. And nowadays, we have some more tracers called as actinium-223, which emits alpha rays also. And these tracers are labeled with somatostatin receptor analogs. And we can combine therapy based on diagnostic information from the PET CT. And this is nowadays called as theragnostics and is a very important treatment option available in many of the malignancies, especially of neuroendocrine tumors or even prostate cancers, where we do a diagnostic imaging and we see whether the patient is expressing a target receptor or antigen, and then we take it for targeted therapy. So these targets can be antigens or G protein coupled receptors or enzymes, and antibodies or mini bodies are developed against this antigen, and this is labeled with a cytotoxic unit or a imaging unit. So gallium-68 is a imaging unit, or we have lutetium-177, yttrium-90, bismuth-213, or rhodesium, cuprum. Many tracers are being developed for this targeted molecular imaging and therapy, which is going to change the management of many otherwise tumors which were otherwise thought of as we cannot do anything, or the people used to give up earlier. So in all cases, this is a famous landmark publication, Netter 1 trial, which was published in NEJM in 2017. In these patients, this study showed that in overall survival and even disease-free survival, even survival advantages are being given by nuclear medicine based therapies. Here are some, these are actually not medullary cytoid, but a metastatic neuroendocrine tumor. I just wanted to show as a for the sake of completion. So here you can see initially this patient had multiple somatostatin receptor expressing tumors, all these black spots, and he received two cycles of therapy, and in subsequent images the intensity of uptake has significantly reduced. So this treatment plan is being evolved, and many other radio tracers are being developed, and phase 3 clinical studies are being done nowadays. And since this therapy is available only since last 5 to 6 years, we have to wait for some more time before the standard guidelines are established or published. So to summarize, in head and neck malignancies, FDG PET CT has established itself as a very important investigation, both for primary diagnosis and in the follow-up or radiotherapy planning or surgical planning. And non-FDG PET CT is developing where FDG PET CT is not useful. And in the future, after as we see, we more and more centers are doing this kind of peptide receptor radioligand therapy or targeted therapy, we will and also many advances are being done in technology to increase the yield and production and to reduce the cost of these treatments. Thank you for your hearing. This is our center in Bangalore. We have a gamma camera and PET CT, and also a therapy facility for many of the thyroid cancer, as well as lutetium based therapy for many of the neuroendocrine tumors. Thank you. If there are any questions, I would be happy to answer.
Yeah, there are a few questions, Murali. Thank you very much for that wonderful talk on PET CT. So before we go for questions, I have a few announcements to our esteemed audience. One is, today evening we have two more presentations by me. One is from 5 to 6 p.m. Indian time. That's on secret success with endoscopic sinus surgery. Then for otology buffs, we have introductory session on otology ninja. That's from 8 to 9 p.m. Indian time. And friends who are interested to register for otology ninja and presentation skills, do it fast. So because it's only for 100 participants each, not more than that, because that's an interactive program. We can't have a big audience. Okay, whoever is interested, please register fast. Coming to the questions, the first question is, what is the sensitivity of FDG uptake for non-squamous cell carcinoma, as such adenocarcinoma and lymphoma etc? Somebody has asked. Dr. Jasin. Yeah.
So,
for,
FDG PET CT is highly sensitive even for adenocarcinomas and lymphomas. Okay. Except for very low grade lymphomas like small cell lymphomas, most of the other lymphomas are FDG abit. And most of the adenocarcinomas, whether lung or salivary gland or any other adenocarcinomas, are also FDG abit. Except for few mucinous variants, most of the other adenocarcinomas are FDG abit.
Okay.
For both for primary as well as lymphomas.
Yeah, it's sensitive. That means, okay.
Yeah.
Dr. Anshul is asking sensitivity of PET CT for nodes less than 5 millimeter.
Less than 5 millimeter is definitely much, much less. See, basically, there is an inherent resolution limit. I did not get into the details of physics of PET CT. So, any positron, before it gets annihilated with electron, the studies say that it traverses at least a distance of around 2 to 3 millimeters. So therefore, there is an inherent resolution limit of 3 millimeter, and because of reconstruction techniques or because of detector sensitivity and other such limitations, less than 5 millimeter is, I will say, 20 to 30%. But again, it depends on the tumor burden and the aggressiveness of the tumor. Sometimes, okay, if the primary tumor is very, very aggressive, even less than 5 millimeter, it can be sensitive. But okay, in general, if you want a figure, it will be around 20 to 30%.
Okay.
And more than and 5 to 8 millimeter, it is around 20 to 60 or 70%. More than 8 millimeter, it is definitely more than 80%.
Okay. So, Dr. Prakash Munka, sir, from Bokaro, another senior ENT surgeon, is asking where PET CT gives false values. Probably he means false positives. You covered it a little bit. You can repeat for his sake.
Any infectious lesion, whether tubercular or non-tubercular. For example, some patient may have caries tooth with a enlarged upper JD node, upper level 2 nodes. In such patients, we can have false positive results. And in children or younger patients, even in 15 to 20 year patients, they usually have reactive cervical lymph nodes. But in such cases, usually the uptake is diffuse, the reactive nodes. But tubercular or any other bacterial infection, or if the patient has any skin infection in the head and neck region or in the scalp, that can also have false positive results.
Okay, great. Okay. How significant is SUV value in identifying recurrent residual tumor and in post radiotherapy fibrosis? Dr. Dinesh Kumar is asking.
Sir, initially only I made it clear.
Yes,
nuclear medicine physicians, we don't rely on SUV value for differentiating malignancy versus benign. So I showed you in the follow-up, we follow something called as Hopkins criteria, whether the uptake is diffuse or focal. So okay, this is a Hopkins criteria. So we always look at the background versus the lesion uptake. So all these IJV, liver, mediastinal uptake, all these fall under the category of background activity. And whether the lesion activity is significantly higher. When we say significantly higher, at least we'll say 2 to 3 times higher than the background activity. And whether it is focal. And also we will see the CT, whether there is any structural pathology. In head and neck, in younger patients, there is a lot of interference from brown fat FDG uptake. So this, so always we have to look for a structural change and also compare it with background activity and not just ACV value.
Okay, good. In case of hypoperfusion, cases. What about FDG? Any other PET CT modalities like metronidazole or propranolol are being used?
Hypoperfusion. Not clear. It may be hypoxia rather than
maybe hypoxia. I mean maybe.
Hypoxia, which results in hypoperfusion. Mm-hmm. See, again, in such cases, many studies were like metronidazole many tracers were developed, but they have not become popular because specificity is always an issue. For example, radiation-induced hypoxia, central necrosis. There is one copper 64-based tracer which is being developed, but they have not become popular for two reasons. One is they need separate radio tracers to label it with these metronidazoles or analogs, and this radio tracer is not available. So therefore, finally, we have to rely on FDG PET-CT only and biopsy. And propranolol is not useful for hypoxia imaging. Mm-hmm. Propranolol is used in case of to suppress brown fat FDG uptake in younger patients. But again, brown fat FDG uptake expression is variable and also depends on season to season. In winter, the brown fat expression is higher. But in adult patients, we think twice before giving the propranolol or any other beta blocker, because many of these head and neck patients are would have come post chemotherapy or fasting, and the propranolol induces hypotension. We don't want any kind of situation in a department.
See,
nowadays, since we get a CT by default in PET-CT, in earlier publications, they were all publications based on only on PET, not on PET-CT. So in such cases, all these factors were important. Hypoxia, brown fat, FDG uptake, muscular uptake, and other such things. See, if you see only this image, you cannot make out. But when you have a CT along with PET, most of those limitations we can overcome.
That's true. And the sensitivity of PET-CT for metastatic lung nodules of less than 5 millimeter.
Again, same principle holds same as principle. In the head and neck. It does not the inherent physics limitation, but also depends on the tumor aggressiveness and tumor burden in the lymph node.
You get malignant totitis externa cases for PET scan, PET CT?
Rarely we get malignant skull-based osteomyelitis. Skull-based osteomyelitis. Definitely, we can use both FDG PET-CT and FAT in bone scan in such cases. But FDG PET-CT is recommended. And it is supposed to be better than MRI. But we don't get lot of cases. As such, the incidence itself is very less. But definitely, FDG PET-CT has some role in measuring the activity, especially after chemo, after antibiotic therapy. 4 to 6 weeks later, if you are planning any radical surgeries, to measure the activity, you can do a FDG PET-CT.
Okay, great. And timing of PET-CT after radiotherapy treatment, you have any protocol?
I told, we prefer to wait for 8 to 12 weeks.
8 to 12
as
weeks.
As much as possible. But, said there that. Is, but if there is a doubt of any residual disease earlier only, then you can do earlier also.
Okay, good. See, can PET-CT differentiate between a lymphoma and Warthin's tumor of parotid?
No, I told earlier only. Lymphoma of parotid, isolated lymphoma of salivary glands is very, very, very rare. And Warthin's tumor usually has got very well-defined margins. And in Warthin's tumor, we have one more tracer, our routine technetium pertechnetate imaging. So, pertechnetate, all the Warthin's tumor are highly, highly pertechnetate avid. I mean, they concentrate technetium pertechnetate image. So, whenever we have a doubt on FDG PET-CT, if there is any doubt of it being a Warthin's tumor, very well-defined tumor, not locally aggressive, not infiltrated any other structures, no other lesions, we call the patient 1 or 2 days after the PET-CT and do a technetium pertechnetate image scanning. So, to see whether there is any uptake.
So, you routinely use Hopkins criteria?
We use. Our interpretation is based on the background versus lesion activity.
Okay. And one of our ENT colleagues asked, is there any evidence or study which says, which suggests the thing superiority of PET CT over pan endoscopy?
Pan endoscopy may be gold standard, but you have to do all the three scans with an equally meticulous way.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and the patient cooperation is very important. He may not be willing. In the same setting, under general anesthesia, you have to see. But there is no direct comparison. There are few studies which showed PET CT picked up some lesions which were missed on pan endoscopy, especially in the digestive tract. For local head and neck lesions, where video endoscopy, laryngoscopy may be good. But other aerodigestive tract, in the digestive tract or even in lungs or other such cases may be missed on pan endoscopy. But more important is, it is rather than superiority, it is convenience wise.
Okay.
PET CT is more convenient, less invasive, and you can, instead of doing three endoscopies, based on PET CT, you can plan either a single endoscopy, like either laryngoscopy or video endoscopy, or only GI endoscopy, or only bronchoscopy, based on PET CT findings.
Okay. Could you elaborate a little bit on indication of DOTA scan in medullary carcinoma thyroid?
In medullary carcinoma thyroid, primary upfront imaging also you can use. I mean, like if the calcitonin is elevated and FNAC shows medullary say thyroid, gallium 68 DOTA-NOC can be used for upfront primary diagnosis,
okay.
Especially if you have any doubt of metastasis. And in follow-up, definitely, if the calcitonin is very high and if the primary histopathology shows well differentiated with a low K67 and low mitotic index, then DOTA-NOC is indicated. But if it is more aggressive, then FDG is indicated. Sometimes both may be needed.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, another friend is asking, isn't pan endoscopy a cheaper option going for the PET CT? But that is, we have to, you know, value, judge between.
Sir, I think it is almost same rate, sir.
Yeah. In some settings, it's expensive actually.
In some settings, it is expensive. So pan endoscopy will cost around 15,000 to 20,000 rupees, to the best of my knowledge.
In smaller hospitals.
Smaller hospitals, it may be around 10,000 to 12,000 at least.
Yeah.
Even PET CT nowadays is being done at 15,000 to 20,000 rupees.
Yeah, true.
But the advantage is you will have staging information upfront.
Okay.
Whereas with pan endoscopy, even if you detect, a staging investigation is needed.
Okay. There's one more question. Is it preferable to get a PET scan in place of CT scan in an irradiated hypopharyngeal malignancy?
Yeah, definitely.
Because edema making the diagnosis of residual or recurrence. Any guidelines suggesting PET scan?
There are definitely, sir. Even NCCN in post chemo radiotherapy, PET CT is better than routine CT.
Yeah, that's true. Okay, Dr. Murli, excellent lecture, and also you have clarified all the doubts, everything, and the audience is very, very happy.
Thank you, sir.
Had about 280 participants from 18 different countries. So really, that is heartening. Huh?
Thank you so much.
I thank again all audience for your wonderful support to our programs. And we are not going to limit this program only for lockdown period. This is going to be a forever. We are going to continue this forever on different topics. We are going to have different guests in the program. We'll have definitely bring this thing. Thank you very much, audience. Again, let us meet again at 5 p.m. in the evening and 8 p.m. in the evening.